Welcome class. Today we are going to look into a major restriction on the exclusive monopoly conferred by copyright. The whole proprietarian conception of copyright, coming as it does with its philosophy of property essentialism, considers the copyright owner to be the sole authority and with absolute discretion, limited by nothing, to deal with the property as he pleases. Compulsory licenses challenge this philosophy. In a sense, compulsory licenses replace the ex post determination of the value of the copyrighted work, either by an independent adjudicator or by an administrative machinery put in force by the government. And they substitute this ex post determination with an ex ante determination by a similar body of the value of this particular work and the royalty payable for exploitation of the work by a third party. So the third party, before making use of the work in question, is aware of what the rate of royalties are, and all he needs to do is to apply for a license and pay the royalty as determined prior to this. Of course, this may not be the only structure through which compulsory license works. But in any case, the important aspect here is the very socialization of copyright. And when using the word socialization, of course, one has to be open to the kind of loaded connotations that it may carry. Yet, one can choose to use that word for the simple reason that a private property right is, through the mechanism of a compulsory license, sought to be made a social right. Instead of an absolute property right, which is governed by property rules, wherein if you step into my property, I will sue you, to a more liability-oriented regime where you can step in, but you just need to pay the rates of royalties as fixed by the license. And the license itself is, in some sense, coerced through the machinery of the state. One can clearly say that there is an attempt to make a private property right into a social right. Now, the way the social right operates, again, apart from the whole ex post and ex ante determination, could be to go with carving out licenses at special rates, carving out licenses for special class of licensees, or even both. So various different combinations are used by the law as it currently stands in order to provide for such compulsory licenses in respect of different kinds of works. Before we get into a close examination of the Indian law that governs compulsory licenses under the Copyright Act, it is imperative to take a look at what the international conventions say on the permissibility of a compulsory license. How is it that the law looks at these licenses? Are these exceptions or these facets of the very right in question? If they are exceptions, under what situations and conditions can such exceptions be provided? For starters, the Berne Convention provides for a general exception in Article 9. This is the three-step test contained in Article 9, wherein as long as the legitimate interests of the right holder are not unfairly prejudiced, and an exception does not conflict with the normal exploitation of the work, member states can in certain special cases provide for exceptions on the exclusivity of the right contained or provided for by copyright law. This is of course a very general exception. Apart from this general exception, the appendix to the Berne Convention by way of articles 2 and 3 does indeed provide for compulsory licenses, and India is also a signatory to the appendix in addition to the main treaty. Article 2 of the appendix explicitly permits member countries to replace the exclusive right of translation in respect of published works with a system of non-exclusive and non-transferable licenses. These licenses are granted in situations where the translation is not published or authorized by the owner of the right of translation in a language in general use in the opting member country within a period of 3 years from the date of first publication of the work in question. So the very idea here is that the owner of the work is given an option to either translate or not translate, and there is a 3-year window. If the translation does not happen within the 3-year period in a language that is commonly used in the member country, then there is no longer a requirement to go to the owner and give him that property right in respect of the translation. Rather, the law says that there is a compulsory license that you will obtain from the state, and you can make use of that as a translator who wishes to translate that particular work. All you need to do is pay the rates of royalty as fixed. Similarly, Article 3 provides for situations where the published work is not made available at prices reasonable on a comparable scale for similar works. In such cases too, a compulsory license can be granted in replacement of the exclusive reproduction right, and the licensee can then make these works available at prices which are reasonable in that particular member country. Similarly, the Universal Copyright Convention also provides for licenses in respect of translation of published works and reproduction of works that are unavailable in the country upon payment of just compensation. So what we see here is a regime that is very similar in its working to the principle of eminent domain that we see in the context of actual real property, where the philosophy is to gauge whether there is a public interest, and in the presence of a public interest to appropriate property but upon payment of just compensation. But the fact that just compensation is mentioned here as a restriction on the power to grant or effect the grant of a compulsory license should not make us in a causally reflexive way to assume that copyright is private property but in the intellectual property space. There are nuances to copyright law that make it different from pure property rights in the physical space, including the fact that it is non-rivalrous and the fact that there are many other variables and dimensions to copyright, such as the fact that expressive content can be used to further free speech and expression. Having said that, the structure of compulsory licenses is indeed very similar to what we see in the real property space, and therefore a lot of the discussion from the level of policy making to judicial interpretation of the provision has bordered around usage of metaphors in the real property law space. This is something that we will see soon enough. To sum up the above discussion, it is pretty evident from the international conventions that India is signatory to, including the Geneva Phonograms Convention, that compulsory licenses are not unique to the Indian model of copyright law and protection. There are provisions that authorize compulsory licenses that exist on the ground, and the Indian law makes use of some of them and their structure, and in some situations it does indeed deviate, but eventually follows a similar philosophy. Whenever there is a public interest involved, the law slowly moves its focus or emphasis from a proprietarian understanding of copyright to a more regulatory understanding. And compulsory licenses and statutory licenses are a strong source of bringing in regulation to the exclusive or otherwise exclusive property right that copyright is largely envisaged as being, or at least perceived as being. With this, we can move to the provisions in the Indian law that deal with compulsory and statutory licenses, the preconditions and the governing situations wherein such licenses can be granted, and other matters incidental therewith. A good place to start would be the categorization of these licenses into five broad categories. These are licenses in respect of works unreasonably withheld from the public, licenses in respect of orphan works, licenses in respect of works for the differently abled, translation licenses, and licenses in respect of reproduction and sale of works unavailable in India. Section 31 of the Act, which deals with licenses in respect of works that are withheld from the public, is indeed one of the most controversial provisions when it comes to the aspect of compulsory licensing, and therefore we'll dive straight into that. This provision has a few preconditions. The first is that it is applicable to any work and it must already have been published or performed in public, that is the work in question. The second is that there must be a complaint alleging that the copyright owner has refused to allow the republication of the work or to allow broadcasting of the work on terms that the complainant considers reasonable. The third is a reasonable opportunity of hearing to the copyright owner. And the fourth is a satisfaction on the part of the adjudicating copyright board that the grounds for refusal by the copyright owner are not reasonable. So the structure of this provision entails the filing of a formal complaint by an applicant for a compulsory license and the showing of some of these preconditions by the applicant. Once the applicant satisfies the copyright board that there has been an unreasonable refusal to broadcast the work, and as a result of which the work is being withheld from the public, in that event the copyright board can then direct the registrar of copyrights to issue a compulsory license in respect of the work in question. There are many controversies that surround this provision. One of the major controversies is regarding the grant of bulk licenses for several works. Can there be one application, or has there to be many more applications, as in multiple applications in respect of different works? Currently, the philosophy, or at least the way the law is being implemented, it looks as though one application is enough, and this is based on the experience of working with one particular set of disputes in the broadcasting industry, wherein radio broadcasters had filed compulsory license applications against the owners of sound recordings, multiple sound recordings, but in the form of one particular complaint to cover all these recordings. There, the copyright board and even subsequently the Bombay High Court and the Supreme Court seem to take the view that one application would suffice to cover the different works. The next important question is, what do you lay down as the correct test to assess whether just compensation has been paid? Because the provision again speaks of payment of compensation. So what is compensation? In the first set of disputes before the Copyright Board in 2002, the applications filed by the radio broadcasters, as mentioned now, the board took the view that in the interim period, that is before the disposal of the main application for the compulsory license, the court could still fix rates of royalty based on a best judgment assessment. Now, this was challenged and it went up to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court, in a manner akin to equating copyright with the broad proprietarian philosophy of being covered as part of the rights of private property held by an individual constitutionally, held that there cannot be confiscation of such property without payment of compensation, and compensation by its very definition had to mean something which was equivalent to the worth of that particular property. So here we clearly see a sort of merging of the proprietarian doctrine with the socialist philosophy of a compulsory license, when the court is trying to read in the proprietarian dimension to the social license, rightly or wrongly. This is also seen in the court's approach to the grant of interim compulsory licenses, where the Supreme Court has quite recently taken the conclusive position that one cannot grant such licenses, that the Copyright Board cannot grant such interim licenses, and that licenses can only be granted after a final disposal of the applications. The reason the court again took this view, at least as evident from the concurring opinion by Justice Chalamet, if not from the majority, is that there is a very serious right involved here, and the right is being derogated from, and when there is a derogation of the right, it can only be based on evidence led at the time of trial. And what is this right? Justice Chalamet indicates that this is nothing but the property right. So again, the proprietarian dimension of copyright is brought in here and kind of superimposed on a social licensing scheme in a manner which attempts to merge the two different philosophies. Now, in practice, this provision has not really worked in the best manner as one would desire, as amply borne out by the set of disputes relating to the radio industry. Compulsory licenses applied for in 2002 got mired in litigation and were finally disposed by the board in 2010 and have led to further litigation. So the way the provision currently seems to work, it is mired in considerable ambiguity and absolute lack of clarity on the way in which royalties must be determined by the Copyright Board. The board in its 2010 order has fixed the rate of royalty based on a percentage of the net advertisement revenue earned by the radio stations. The counter standard, which is sought to be put in place by the content owners, and which they argue is an equivalent or a just equivalent of what the work is worth, is based on needle hour rates and they argue that radio stations must pay based on rates fixed per needle hour, that is the time when music is actually played in any particular hour over the radio station in question. The law currently provides no guidance in respect of any of these matters, and hence the provision remains an unworkable formula in respect of providing access to works withheld from the public. Quickly moving on to orphan works and the compulsory licensing provision. Orphan works are a term of art denoting situations where the author of the work is dead, unknown or untraceable, or the copyright owner cannot be found. The application here is under section 31A by any person who is desirous of publishing or communicating to the public such work or a translation of such work. The main conditions for pre application and the consequential grant are publication of the applicant's proposal in a English daily newspaper, deposit of royalty by the applicant to any account specified by the board. Empirically, this provision has not been used much, but it may have a lot of relevance post the growth of the Google Books project, because many of the works which Google Books project seeks to reproduce are orphan works. So what happens with these orphan works? Can Google Books, for instance, go ahead and do what they were like? No. Section 31A exists, and as long as it is in the statute books, they will have to comply with the provision in order to reproduce it as part of their database. But it does certainly provide them with a way out. Though the provision may not be entirely conducive in terms of publication in the newspaper and so on, at least as a matter of its philosophical justification, it seems a laudable provision to have. This is the case with Section 31B2, because it provides for compulsory licenses in respect of works for the benefit of the differently abled. Persons working for their benefit on a profit basis can apply for compulsory licenses to publish the work, and there aren't too many preconditions attached to the exercise of this provision as well. The applicant has to first serve the copyright owner or the publisher with a copy of the application, and once the board is satisfied with the credentials and good faith conduct of the applicant, it can grant such licenses expeditiously. The license only has to specify the means and format of publication, the period during which the license may be exercised, and the number of copies that may be issued, including the rate or royalty payable to the copyright owner. So this fairly simple provision can go a long way if enforced the right way by people who are in the business of providing works for the benefit of the differently abled, by preventing hold-up, time delay, and so on, and giving them easy access to the work upon payment of royalty. You may recollect that I had earlier mentioned Articles 2 and 3 of the Appendix to the Berne Convention, which in turn respectively dealt with translation and reproduction licenses. These provisions, which India had been signatory to, are transposed or transported to our regime by way of Section 32(1)(a) and 32(a). Translation licenses are provided for under 32(1)(a) and are available in respect of teaching, scholarship and research purposes, and for literary or dramatic works in non-Indian languages. That is, the original work is in a non-Indian language. These licenses do not ensue in cases where the copyright owner has already authorized the circulation of copies of the translated work. The applicant also has to establish that he had requested and been denied authorization by the copyright owner to produce and publish such translation, or that he was unable to find the copyright owner despite the exercise of due diligence. It is only when these preconditions are satisfied and the board also feels that the applicant is competent to produce and publish a correct translation of the work and can provide payment of royalties for the copyright owner, that the board will permit the grant of such licenses. Similarly, reproduction licenses, which are available for works that are not made at prices reasonable to the Indian market, are availed for any literary, scientific or artistic works. Here the law makes a distinction between works that are used as part of systematic instructional activity and other works. So in the case of works that are used as part of systematic instructional activity, the copyright owner has a duty to ensure availability of these copies at prices reasonably comparable with that of similar works in India. The applicant only has to satisfy the board that he has requested and been denied authorization by the owner of the copyright, and that he is competent to reproduce and publish an accurate reproduction of the work, and can pay royalties due to the copyright owner. Thus, we see that the Indian law works in a very graded sort of way when it comes to enforcing compulsory licenses in respect of reproductions and translations, where the gradation is between the broad category of literary and musical works, and then from there proceeding to works which are used as part of instructional activity, and works that are used for teaching, research and scholarship, and then works which are in languages that are not commonly used in a developed country. So in this very graded sort of way, the Indian law seeks to protect access to different works that are used by students and other entities in India. The last leg of our discussion today looks at one particular kind of compulsory licenses where there is no precondition of an application to be requested by an applicant for the grant of that particular compulsory license. On the other hand, the board itself fixes the rates of royalties on an ex ante basis in respect of all categories of works that qualify for the purposes of this provision. And as long as the royalties fixed by the board in respect of the broad category of that work is paid by the applicant, he can continue using that work, and all he needs to do is to intimate usage of that particular work through such license to the owner of the work. So this is broadly under the category of what one may call statutory licenses. Licenses where the rates of royalty are fixed in advance by the copyright board and as authorized by the statute. There are two broad cases or situations where these licenses can be granted. One is version recordings, and the other is the grant of licenses for sound recordings for radio stations and other broadcasting organizations. So as we have already seen in the case of the latter, that is the broadcasting organizations, there was already a provision in section 31, that is the compulsory license for works that were unreasonably withheld. Now the difference here and the difficulty earlier was that, you know, every radio broadcaster had to basically file an application for grant of such license. Now the present provision, that is section 31D, that has been introduced by virtue of the 2012 amendment, specifically mandates the fixation of royalties by the copyright board. And once the copyright board fixes these royalties, then there is no requirement of any application to be filed by each individual broadcaster. All that the broadcaster has to then do is to pay that certain royalty that has been fixed by the copyright board. And once he is willing to pay that and makes such payment to the owner of the copyright, he can continue using that particular work. Even with version recordings, in fact, this particular formula was already in place, but it was just that the provision was earlier found as part of the fair use enumerations in section 52. So with version recordings, the way it has worked till now, that is even prior to section 31C, which was introduced by way of the 2012 amendment, is that the version recordist has to inform the owner of copyright in the musical or literary work, as the case may be, he has to basically make it clear that he is desirous of making version recordings of that work, and he has to pay the royalties which have been fixed by the copyright board. So upon payment of such royalties, he can continue using it, and the permission is not an issue at all. Whether the copyright owner is reasonably agreeable, whether he disagrees with the rates fixed by the copyright board, whether any negotiation has to happen, none of this is at all an issue, because the way the statutory licenses work, they preclude any sort of negotiation. From the beginning, there is a certain rate that has been fixed by the board. You pay that certain rate, you go ahead and use that particular work. All you need to do is comply with the conditions of the license. So in the case of version recording, there are certain factors that there are certain conditions that have been imposed by the board, like for instance that you cannot misrepresent as though you are the original recording, sound recording of that particular work. You are only a version recording, so you have to kind of not piggyback on an existing recording of the work. You cannot use, for instance, the photographs of the actors who acted in that particular film and so on and so forth. So you can't, basically use the opportunity to piggyback. Second, you cannot, of course, make a cinematograph film based on the recording, because the recording version recording provision is only in respect of making sound recordings and not in respect of making a cinematograph film. So if you need to make a cinematograph film, then you need to take a separate license in respect of that particular underlying work. But as long as these conditions are satisfied or you do not violate the terms of the license, you don't need to establish any unreasonable refusal on the part of the copyright owner, and the copyright owner's permission is not at all in question. So this provision is very controversial now in Section 31D, because earlier under Section 31, obviously the radio broadcaster or even the television broadcaster, though no such licenses were ever filed by television broadcasters, but all of them would have had to establish that there is an unreasonable refusal on the part of the copyright owner, and most times the unreasonable refusal would be due to seeking hefty payments of royalties. But now nothing of that sort. All you need to do is to first, get the copyright board to fix these royalties. Of course, while fixing the royalties, the copyright board does look into certain factors such as there is a distinction in the rules between radio broadcasting and television broadcasting. The board can look into the peak hours when the work is being used on radio stations and the non-peak hours and fix different royalties for the different times. For instance, even the owner of the work can go before the board and establish that there is considerable expenses, and to show that this is the capital investment involved in creating these works, and so on and so forth. So these various factors can be looked into by the board, but finally a blanket rate of royalty is fixed by the board, and all that the broadcaster, any broadcaster, has to do is to pay that blanket rate of royalty and go ahead. So this is where the Indian law currently stands on compulsory licensing, and we need to see how the court applies these provisions. In fact, the constitutional validity of some of these provisions introduced in the 2012 amendment have been challenged, and they are currently pending before the courts. And we have to see whether these provisions stand constitutional scrutiny as well, because if the court takes a strict propertarian dimension of copyright, then one could argue that this violates right to property, it also violates the right to carry on trade and so on. But the whole idea behind these compulsory licenses is, as I mentioned in the beginning of the class, to bring in a kind of social dimension or social right angle to this idea of copyright as an exclusive monopoly, and bring in that variable and try and bring about some form of distributive justice, some form of access enhancement and so on through the use of these licenses. So I think with that, we can, keeping the thought in mind, we can look at how the court may possibly decide statutory licenses and their future in the Indian context as well. And with that, on that note, I think we can conclude this lecture. Thank you for your patient attendance.